All right, so welcome to the Pease Community Information Q&A session on the remedial investigation. It is May 19th, 2021, and I'm Ona Ferguson from the Consensus Building Institute, gonna sort of guide us through today's session, but mostly help you all talk to each other. And I'm gonna turn this over to Val De La Fuente from the Air Force to kick us off.
All right. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, great. Well, welcome everyone to the PEAS, PFAS remedial investigation, or what we call an RI, question and answer session. Again, my name is Val De La Fuente. I'm the acting branch BRAC program manager for the PEAS program right now. I wanted to thank Roger Walton publicly for his excellent work the past few years on the program. He departed a month ago for an Army promotion, so that grit to him, and he's still doing well. So kudos to him for all his work. As I said, I'm the Eastern Branch Chief, so I've also had this base for 10 years, so I'm very familiar with the base. It's an exciting program, as I've witnessed for the past month, and I'm glad to be here tonight. This meeting is a supplement to the PEAS Restoration Advisory Board meetings. They're held every quarter. It's the latest opportunity to provide the community visibility into the work we're doing. And members of the RAB, as you know, have been very involved in the planning of the work that we're gonna conduct this summer, spring, summer, and fall. As many of you know, the final RI work plan was posted online on the AFCAC Administrative Record website. If after this meeting you need to get a hold of it, you can contact the contact information on the slides. And also a fact sheet was prepared for the RI on the RI for this meeting. So that's also available. Anyway, I welcome this opportunity to inform the RAB and the public on the details of the RI work plan and answer any questions you may have about the work. I've got my experts on the line tonight, and I also like to add that the next PEAS RAB meeting is the 9th of June. So I'd like to plug the RAB. So I know we'll do that at the end of the call as well. So 9 June. I don't have anything else. I want to go ahead and go right into the presentation. So whoever is next on the thing, go ahead.
Perfect. Thank you. So one quick thing, just because this is virtual, if you have an affiliation and want to add that to your name, if it's relevant for this project, please go ahead and do that. For those who didn't hear me say it, we put asterisks at the front of sort of the project staff for this meeting. So if someone's talking, you know that they're coming from sort of the planning side. We are going to go into presentation. I think we have sort of 20, 30 minutes of content to share with you, maybe less, just depending on how it goes. And we're gonna look to the team from Wood to give that. We're gonna go to Amy Quinton and Hank and Andisek for that content. The Wood team is taking notes. What I'm imagining tonight is like us sitting in the big DES space around a bunch of tables and around a bunch of maps going, okay, what's gonna happen where? What should you expect to see in coming months, and why are we doing it? All of that and some casual back and forth. So this is our best virtual version of that. So as we go, if you have clarifying questions during the presentation, feel free to put questions in the chat. Catch my attention, you can use the reaction button to raise your hand, your virtual hand, or if for those of you who have your screens on, you know, like wave an arm and I'll try to actually see you, just depending on sort of what screen is where. And we can do this as a little bit of a back and forth. And in the spirit of that we are recording, I've some encouragement to sort of get through the full presentation so we don't start asking questions that will be answered later in the presentation. So we'll sort of try to get through before too long and then have lots of time for just discussion. And we're planning to be here till 7 if people still are having questions up until 7. Any of that unclear in terms of the process side? You good? All right. Thank you again for being here. And I think let's go to Amy first to get us going.
Thanks, Ona. Get my slide shared. You should be seeing a slideshow, hopefully.
Yep.
Okay, great. All right, thank you very much, Ona, for hosting this. And thanks, Val, for introducing kind of what we're setting out to do tonight. I will take the first part of this slideshow, and you'll be hearing from Hank Andelsek, our senior hydrogeologist tonight as well. So just, I'm trying to figure out where everything goes with Zoom. Typically use Teams, but all right, here we go. All right, so you heard Val talk earlier. So Val is the program manager. As he said, he's very familiar with PEAS, has a longstanding history with the site, which is great. Hank Andelsek is our senior hydrogeologist. He's been instrumental throughout the program so far and throughout the work that's being done now. So he will, once we're done with the slideshow, he'll be taking you through some figures and will be available to answer questions on the specifics as much as you would like to hear. And then I am a human health risk assessor with Wood. And again, that's Wood, the contractor for the Air Force that's implementing this program. So I want to start out by just a little overview of CERCLA. So the work that's done at PEAS is done in this federal framework. So this federal framework, it creates a really consistent way to approach site investigation and cleanup. And it's not specific to PFAS, it's not specific to PEAS, it's applied across federal sites across the US. So this framework has its own terminology. And so when you're hearing the words remedial investigation, what does that really mean? Where does it fall within this process? So if you look across the top row, this is essentially just conceptually what it is that we're doing in each of these phases. So the first one is what sites are potentially a problem? We identify the fact that there could be a source there that could cause a potential risk. So first, it's identifying these sites, doing initial sampling to identify whether or not there is anything there. And then if it turns out that there is and they continue through the process, then we get into this detailed evaluation. So we take a lot more data. We really try to refine, well, where is it? Where is it going? What does that mean? And then from there, we can figure out how to evaluate cleanup options, what cleanup options make sense. And from there, the cleanup plan is actually selected from the different options. It's implemented. And then there's an evaluation process as it goes along. So looking at the CERCLA terminology, the first phase of that is this preliminary assessment and site inspection. And we'll talk more about how that's been implemented at PEAS to date. So that part is done. And then the next step is this remedial investigation. And after that, the feasibility study. And so that's where we are right now. And as Val mentioned, we're starting fieldwork right now, and that fieldwork is all documented in the remedial investigation work plan, which is available for further review for those that would like to. And so once the remedial investigation phase is finished, the cleanup plan selection is documented in something called a ROD, so a record of decision. So that would be the next step in the process. And then from there, remedial design, implementation, and long-term management. So as I said, the CERCLA process, not specific to PFAS, but what is PFAS? So PFAS is, it stands for per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances. There is a picture here of an example substance. It's basically a carbon chain with a bunch of fluorination. So there's fluorine atoms stuck to the edges of it. They can be various different lengths, various different amounts of fluorine. there's some important things about PFAS which made it versatile and useful for a lot of different things, actually. And one of those things is this aqueous film forming foam, so AFFF. But it basically has different properties in the head and the tail. So the head of the chemical has hydrophilic properties, and the tail is hydrophobic and lipophobic. So you can use these chemicals to create stain-resistant coatings, water-resistant coatings. They're wonderful surfactants. So they've had a lot of use because of these chemical properties. And they also, it's a very, very stable bond. It's basically the most stable chemical bond, this carbon-fluorine bonds. And so they're really hard to break down. So that makes them heat resistant. So because of this, they were used in a lot of different applications. And one of those applications was this aqueous film-forming foam, which was used at a lot of airports. It was used at a lot of military bases, petroleum storage. It's very good at putting out petroleum fires. And so AFFF is essentially the main source of PFAS that we've been investigating at PEAS. PFAS is a large chemical class. There are a lot of different PFAS compounds. They're not all necessarily used in any one specific product. A lot of them have not been largely evaluated, investigated. We don't have a lot of toxicity information for most of the PFAS. So the RAI at this point is going to focus on 25 PFAS. So for any sample that we send to the lab, we'll get back concentrations and tell us how much PFAS is there of 25 different chemicals for each of those samples. And that list includes PFOS and PFOA. And if you're familiar with PFAS, you know that those are the two that have essentially the most research at this point, and they form the basis of the drinking water health advisory. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about PEAS. So PEAS, it's a former Air Force base. If we look at the figure on the right-hand side, there's a few different lines there. So this red dashed line on the outside, this is the former installation boundary. So when the Air Force was operating this from the 50s to 1991, this would have been the extent of the site. At this point, the PDA owns land, which is this black hatched line. And then the current airport outline, which is fenced, is this this purple line here. So this is where PEAS sits on the peninsula. We'll talk more about Site 8 up here in the north, which is essentially the high point. And Hank will go into some more detail on that probably in his figures as well. So when I talked about CERCLA on that first big slide with all the boxes, when a site starts the CERCLA process, we say that it's listed on the national priorities list. So PEAS was listed back in 1990. And it was listed for solvents and fuels. It wasn't listed for PFAS. At that point, no one was sampling for PFAS chemicals. So a lot of work has been done at PEAS that predates all of the PFAS investigation. And there were actually 11 records of decision that were documented in the 90s. So if we were to recall again from that CERCLA figure, the record of decision is when a specific cleanup is decided on and documented. So there has been a certain amount of cleanup, quite a lot that's already happened at PEAS. So the PFAS story starts in 2013. So I'm just gonna go through a few of the highlights of what's happened so far for PFAS. So it started in 2014 when the Haven well was taken offline. So the Haven water supply well, it was a public water supply well. When it was sampled for PFAS, they found specifically PFOS, which is one chemical that was detected above what at the time was the provisionary health advisory level. So this was obviously potentially a problem. So it was taken offline immediately, and then additional work was started to look at other potential drinking water, PFAS in drinking water. So essentially the other municipal wells. So the Haven is one of a few different wells. So the other wells, of course, were also tested. A Century well program was initiated in order to make sure that PFAS was not too close to those other wells and to identify that the exceedances wouldn't be happening anytime soon in those wells. We started the private well inventory and actually started sampling private wells, and that's an ongoing program, which is still happening at this point to ensure that PFAS is within acceptable levels within private wells as well as the public water supply wells. So after the initial drinking water evaluations, the next question is, well, where is the PFAS coming from? So it kicked us into the preliminary assessment phase. So if we remember, that's at the very beginning of that CERCLA chart with the boxes. So the first thing that happens is you look largely at a desktop study, and you try to identify, was AFFF used on the site? Whereabouts was AFFF used? Where are the possible places it could have, how much could have been released? Where could it have gone? So this preliminary assessment was done in 2015, and it identified 21 potential release areas of AFFF. And it also identified that there are potentially downgradient receptors. So there's a place, there's a source for AFFF and a place that it could move to. So following the preliminary assessment, the next step is the site inspections. So they did a base-wide site inspection as well as a specific site inspection at site 8, which was known to be a potential source area. And that's when actual media is collected. So soil samples are collected and sent to the lab, groundwater samples are collected and sent to the lab. And as you can see, quite a lot of samples were collected at this point to get an initial look at what the concentrations were at PEAS. And so in order to resolve some of the data gaps that were identified in that first site inspection, a second expanded site inspection was then performed. And this one, not only did it collect some of the abiotic samples, so the groundwater, surface water, but also actually collected some shellfish samples as well. We collected quite a few samples of mussels, oysters, and clams, which were identified as recreational shellfishing is pretty relevant for the Pease Peninsula. And there's also some commercial oyster farms in the Bay Area. So that kind of brings us up to what is essentially current. Once the site inspections were finished, it was decided that there is a source area on PEAS. There is PFAS above specific thresholds. And so then we started the RI process, so the remedial investigation. And the RI process started last year with a very initial sampling round, which was intended to fill in some of the main data gaps and things like surveying seeps along the western boundary to identify where would be a good sampling location. So some preliminary activities occurred in the fall of last year. And a few other pieces have also been moving. So we held several conceptual site model meetings with interested RAB members to talk through different source pathway receptors that were relevant for PEAS. And that also helped us to refine the work plan and improved several of our sampling locations and was quite helpful. And in addition to that, we opened the PEAS hotline, and there's an email, which Val alluded to, which we will also show at the end of the presentation, which we would solicit any information be sent to that email address if, if there are others who have information they feel would be pertinent to the investigation. And the other way in which we've been asking for public feedback is that we have these two questionnaires. So these were mostly intended, questionnaire B is if you have an existing well on your property and has already been inventoried, and most of our, we followed up with most people who received a questionnaire B. So for the most part, I think we've captured most of those responses. Questionnaire A, we sent to anyone who previously was not inventoried to identify if they had a private well. And we also were looking for information on surface water uses. If you have surface water on your property, is it something that you use to irrigate vegetables, or do you wade or swim in it? And questionnaire A is really open to anyone to provide additional feedback. And those are still open. There's multiple ways in which to contact us and provide information. So when we looked at that CERCLA process, kind of the middle of that process after the remedial investigation and the feasibility study is identifying cleanup options and then going through with the cleanup. However, it doesn't mean that interim actions can't be done. And multiple interim actions have been done at Pease. So if we look at this figure, Site 8, as I mentioned before, is up here on the northern end. And Site 8 was initially very early identified as a potential source area, as this is a former fire training area. And groundwater moves off in all directions, as these arrows shows, and into Newington is one of those directions. So there's a treatment plant now at Site 8, which has been operating since 2018. And this is to assist in preventing offsite migration of PFAS. One of the other major interim actions is this Ames system. So this is the airfield interim mitigation system, which again is a groundwater treatment plant, which is intended to reduce migration of PFAS towards the Haven Well and also potentially to Point South. And that's been operating since 2019. There have been some other work done to try to ensure the protection of the Harrison and Smith wells, which are down here in the southern part of the site. So one more look at this CERCLA overview. So everything that we've been talking about so far, most of it falls under the SI, the PA and the SI. So the preliminary assessment and site inspection, which identified PFAS in above thresholds that then indicated we needed to go into the RI process. So the remedial investigation, again, is the piece that we are working on right now, and it's the piece that we'll be talking about for the rest of the presentation. And as this indicates, field work has already started. You might have seen our teams in the area of Newington at this point already collecting samples. So what exactly is an RI? If you go into the Superfund program in US EPA, it gives you a good description of essentially what an RI hopes to do. It's intended to characterize site conditions. So really understanding where is the PFAS, where is it going, what layers is it in the soil, is it mobile, is it moving, and then determining the nature of that. So we call this the nature and extent. And so once that's been sufficiently characterized, then that data will be used to assess human health and the environment. So that's kind of the big overall picture of what the RI in total wants to do. It wants to, figure out where is all the waste, where could it be going? And then, that data will be used to evaluate what the potential risk is to human health and the environment. And then the second part of that is the feasibility study. And that's when the treatability testing, basically it's the evaluation of potential treatment and cleanup options. And so, this is a big ask, identifying the nature and extent of contamination, especially with something that tends to spread like PFAS has. So it can be very iterative. Data gaps will be identified. Supplemental work could be done. As you've seen from the initial work that was done on the site, we went out and did site inspections and then went back and did a second one to try to clarify some of those data gaps. So, it's a big operation and there's some multiple pieces to it and it can be quite iterative as it moves through the process. So what's on the agenda for now? Field work is happening. It's already started in the area and is projected to continue at least until the fall and possibly as far as into the spring. So now I'm gonna turn it over to Hank, who will walk through the next few slides.
All right, thanks, Amy. My name is Hank Andolsek. I'm the project hydrogeologist. I'm from Wood. I've been working on this project site since 2014. So I'm just going to give you an overview of the remedial investigation that we're currently implementing at PE. What we're trying to accomplish is...
Hank, you
broke up a little there, Hank.
For a minute.
Okay.
Wait, can you just say your last couple sentences again? I think we're getting just background noise and not actual words. Can you call in perhaps? I can tell you where to find the phone number. If you go to the little up arrow in the bottom left by the telephone icon, it'll say switch to phone and give you some numbers to call in. I think that's best. And everybody else take a stretch.
Can you hear me now?
Oh,
can you hear
me? That sentence? Yeah.
Okay, I just changed headsets, so hopefully this might work.
Beautiful.
Okay, well, let's try it again. Sorry about that, folks. I seem to be cursed with technology.
Uh-oh, it's happening again. I think we can't hear anything.
He's gonna call in.
Thank you. Thanks for your patience, everyone.
I'm going to have to call in.
That's perfect, Hank.
Okay.
Nobody has any good jokes to put in the chat or something while we're waiting.
Ona?
Yeah.
There is a good question in the chat from Joanne. I don't know if we want to segue to that just yet, but I just want to call your attention to it. And I'm having trouble with my camera, so I don't know what's going on.
But no,
no problem.
Oh, Hank, we'll get you the call-in number.
We can talk through that question while we're waiting if you want.
Great.
This is the what exposure to PEs do current workers have? So what we do is we assess the current workers for, it would be ingestion and dermal contact with soil. So they don't have a lot of exposure, most likely, if workers are going in and out of the airport, for example, they're not necessarily exposed to much, maybe some dust, but they're not drinking water that would be contaminated with PFAS.
I'm back on. Can you hear me now?
Can hear you now.
Okay.
Are you on the phone?
Yep.
I'm on the phone.
Good.
Okay. Oh boy. Okay. Best laid plans. Okay. Where was I? I'm a project hydrogeologist. I've been working on the site since 2014, and objectives of what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you through a brief overview of the are the remedial investigation that we're implementing currently. And at the end of this slideshow, after Amy gets back on and finishes up, we're going to open it up to questions. And I have a series of maps that reflect what is in the scope of work and the work plan. And if anybody has any specific questions regarding what we're doing with respect to the work plan, I can share these maps and we can discuss them. The basic objectives of the RI are to there's three things that we're trying to do. One is investigate known and potential source areas. Second thing is evaluate the contaminant migration pathways, such as surface water and groundwater. And third is identify and evaluate potential receptors along the identified migration pathways. Next slide, please. So we actually began the RI field activities last week. These activities include soil sampling at numerous locations. Surface and subsurface samples are being collected to evaluate migration pathways, as well as evaluate known and potential source areas. The picture that you see on the slide is the type of drilling rig that you might see in the surrounding area that will be used to collect the subsurface soil samples. Many of the surface soil samples we plan to collect are in Newington, in areas of soil referred to as hydric soils, which means a very wet soil. In those areas, we'll be having crews out there with hand sampling devices such as shovels and hand augers. Next slide, please. The groundwater portion of the investigation is looking at contaminant migration pathways. We'll be installing at least 28 new monitoring wells and collecting over 100 samples from new and existing wells. The installation of the wells require a slightly larger drilling rig than used for soil sampling, and the image on this slide is what you might see in the area installing these wells. Next slide, please. We'll be collecting numerous surface water and sediment samples to also look at migration pathways of contaminants from source areas. Samples will be collected from brooks as well as from ponds like the one shown here. Next slide, please. And as Amy stated earlier, before we began the RI, we did some field reconnaissance and to identify seeps along the west side of the peninsula, west of the runway. And seeps are essentially groundwater springs where groundwater comes to the surface and discharges to the ground, as shown in this photo here. There are almost two dozen identified springs along the west side of the airfield that we'll be sampling to evaluate the potential contaminant migration pathway. You'll see some folks, you might see some folks in high-vis vests walking in the woods east of McIntyre Road. And if you do, most likely they're there sampling seeps. Next slide, please. We'll also be taking numerous samples from the installation's underground stormwater conveyance system. The middle image that you see there is the headwater of McIntyre Brook, which is fed by a portion of the system's outfall. So there are numerous, I think it's about 90 samples that we're going to be collecting at various points across the installation of this stormwater system. Next slide, please. And lastly, we're going to be installing lysimeters at known source areas. The picture here is a conceptual drawing of a lysimeter. A lysimeter is a small well that is installed in the unsaturated soil above the water table to collect water percolating down through the soil. So we're using the data that we collect from the lysimeters to evaluate fate and transport of PFAS compounds in the environment. We're looking at how it absorbs to the soil particles as it moves down. So these lysimeters are going to be put in at two different elevations, you know, a shallow and a deep within the soil column. Next slide, please. And Amy's going to take it from here.
I am. Thanks, Hank. All right, so that was a little peek at the investigation. And so once samples are collected, then what happens? So we take the samples and we send them off to the lab on a daily basis. These samples are then analyzed by the lab. And as I said before, there are 25 PFAS chemicals that we'll be analyzing the data for. It takes a couple of weeks, sometimes longer, to get the data back. There is a turnaround time. And then once the data is returned to Wood, it goes through a pretty comprehensive quality assurance process that we call validation. So there is a time lag between when those samples are collected and then when that data can be reviewed. And when the data is reviewed, we go through a process to identify whether or not that data was sufficient in that area based on the objective of collecting the sample. And if it is, then we move forward. And if it isn't, then we may suggest collecting additional samples. As we mentioned, it can be an iterative process. And samples may be collected for multiple reasons. And Hank might walk through an example of this, but essentially, if you're looking for the edge at which a concentration is below a certain threshold, and then you find that it's not, then you might have to move out further and collect another sample. So it could be to understand the nature and extent, or also to support the risk assessment. If, for example, we find another exposure pathway or another possible receptor. So as I mentioned before, the remedial investigation, it's a large process. There's a lot going on. And so we're out in the field collecting data right now, but there are some other pieces that are still in motion. There are two other work plans that are currently in preparation. So one of them is the human health risk assessment methodology. This one is with the regulators at the moment, under review from EPA and New Hampshire DES. And the other one is ecological risk assessment. So when we talked about what an RI hopes to do and what the objectives are, after that data collection, we then have the objective of evaluating risks to human health and the environment. So these two work plans set out the methodology that we will use to do that. So that's still in process. And then there's the fact that it's an iterative process. And this investigation that we're working on right now, it focuses on what we call the abiotic or the non-living things. So it's it's soil, it's groundwater, everything that Hank talked about, but it doesn't deal with biota. So we do have some potential sampling that we are going to do for biota, including sampling gardens in cases where there's PFAS. There's water with PFAS detected in it being used to irrigate fruits and vegetables or livestock. So that sampling is not in this particular work plan. That will be in a supplemental work plan, which has not yet been developed. And then as we identify data gaps in this investigation, particularly on the nature and extent, additional sampling may be required to fill in those data gaps. So the results of this investigation at this point, it's currently scheduled for September 2022. However, there will be interim results before that. Probably fall of 2021 is when we will start looking at and evaluating interim results, which will likely inform, well, they will definitely inform what's going on in the future. And as we know more, we will provide updates at future RAB meetings. And so we've been talking about contact information throughout this talk. There are a couple of different ways to get more information or to provide information to us. This first one will ensure that you are on an email list and you will be notified of future updates to the PSRI. This second one with the wood information is our PSRI hotline. So this goes directly to the wood folks, but of course we are constantly communicating with the Air Force as well. So if you send information here, it will find the right people who are involved in the PSRI program. And then we have Val's contact information here. So again, that would be straight to the Air Force. Great. And with that, that's the end of our presentation. And I will hand it back over to Hank to go through the figures.
All right, thanks, Amy.
Thank you both. So Hank, you're gonna kind of orient people to what we have, is that right?
Well, yes, and I guess I'll just describe what I have here. This is and I'm gonna try to move slowly because some people may be affected, like a vertigo effect if I move too quickly, and I don't wanna make anybody ill, including myself. But I have here on the left-hand column here, this is a table of contents. This is these numbers, you know, 1.6-1 all the way up to 5.3-1. These are all figure numbers that are in, these figures are in the RI work plan. And the ones that are the 5 series on down are actually the scope of work that we're actually performing. Now, some of the other ones, the 1.6, are just some other geologic, some supporting figures that help frame the discussions. So if anybody has any questions about the work plan and the what we're doing at various parts across the peninsula, I can hopefully answer your questions with the series of figures that I have here.
Great, thank you.
I'll just leave it open to questions.
Thank you. I think let's take down the shared image for a moment and just see everybody. Questions, that was all the content we have to share, knowing that Hank has more detail we can go into, sort of following your areas of interest. Like what, this gives you a sense of what you might be seeing in the next 6 or 9 months and what they're doing, why. What else would you like to know? What's not clear?
Are you able to hear me?
Doors open. We can. Hi, Peter. Yeah. Welcome.
Hi. On Peverly Pond, have you done sampling from the pond on the fish?
We have not, no.
Okay, because as a kid, we used to fish in that pond. And, you know, that's through the 50s and 60s. And, of course, the base was pretty active at that time. I also wanted to ask you about where and how, or is there a test? I'm a former firefighter for the Air Force, and I was stationed at Pease in the 70s as a crash rescue firefighter. Is there a test that can be given, a blood test or something, to see if you have levels of this stuff in your system or not?
I think Linda started to respond to that in the chat, suggesting contacting the VA medical provider, and also that we have a RAB member who would be a good contact who works with active duty firefighters at Pease.
Well, I'm long past all that. I was in the service, some years ago. I re, so my question really had to do with the fact about the chemical itself. And if you, because I handled AFFF a lot in those days, and I worked in the firefighting field, and I loaded trucks and was in the fire training right there at Pease in that fire training facility and lit up fires and put them out. My question is, I'm not alone. There's many, 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 many people that did that. Are those folks, is there some form of a test just for the purpose of study that you have that you can do or they do to see what levels of that stuff are in our system, if any? Maybe none of it. I don't know.
I think yes, and I think there are others on this call who know more. I can't answer. Can anybody else shed some light on this?
Peter, yeah, this is Andrea Amico. I'm a co-founder of Testing for Pease, and we advocated for blood testing and health studies for folks at Pease who are affected by PFAS contamination. And yes, there is blood testing that can be done to tell you what levels of PFAS you have in your blood today.
How does one volunteer to do that?
It's complicated. So for you, if you just want to get your blood tested, you know, you'd have to work through your doctor to get that done. And it's not a routine lab. It's not covered by insurance. It's expensive. No,
what I wanted to do, if you're doing it, see, I don't know what the scope of your project is in regard to human factors. I understand it as far as looking at migration and soils and water. And I am interested in the fish out of Pebbly Pond. There's other things I'd like to ask about. But in terms of humans, is there going to be like a place where you all just take a sample and add it to your database to see what's going on with folks like myself, of which I'm sure there's many, many around this area?
So there is a health study going on right now, but it has very specific criteria. It's being done by the CDC. And they're looking at people who drank the water between 2004 and 2014, and they are excluding firefighters from the study because they're looking at the general population, and firefighters have a more complicated pathway of exposure, not only from drinking water, but also handling the foam, also from the gear, and your firefighter gear is impregnated with PFAS. So firefighters are excluded from that study. And also, if you weren't at Pease between 2014 and 2004 too. It sounds like your service was a lot, it was much longer ago.
Oh yeah.
But if you want, Peter, I'm happy if you put your email in the chat. I can certainly connect with you after this meeting and try to give you some more information, try to help you like figure out which labs obtain blood testing, tell you more about what I know in terms of blood testing and health studies, and put you in touch with some other PFAS advocates at the firefighter level too.
Okay. Again, I'm just volunteering to be a guinea pig in the study. That's all. And I'll send you my email. Yeah. Thank you.
Can I just insert something for a second? So there is a registry that's been started, as well as a study by NIOSH that's going on specifically relating to firefighters and their exposure to AFFF. There's also been a new law that I believe as of June 1st goes into effect that all New Hampshire insurance providers have to cover PFAS blood testing now in the state of New Hampshire if your insurance is derived from a New Hampshire company. So speak with your physician in New Hampshire. If you have New Hampshire insurance, it's compelled to be covered by your insurance company now as of, I think, June 1st. But there's also, I can help you too, with information, getting connected to the NIOSH study.
Thank you.
Right, and
thank you. Yeah, that's good of Al.
Yeah, no, just that Mindy caught it, part of it, and we also have some veterans things coming out of the Congress, and Congress had asked for some of this information and some studies, and they're pushing for that kind of stuff. We received your email a few days ago, and we were in the process of putting together some answers for you. So we will be providing you. We too will be providing you information based on your question.
Thank you very much.
So anyway, you'll be getting it from all directions, help hopefully. And if you have questions about where we're sampling, we can definitely explain it. I know I've received a few calls from people who want to know if they'll be sampling their pond and things like that. And there are reasons to do it, and there are reasons not. We may be doing it and we may not be doing it. Of course, we're doing it based on where we think you know, on the directions of flow and what where we think it's going from being groundwater into surface water. But anyway, so we'll be eventually we'll have taken data all around the Newington area, and I assumed you meant Newington. You said Newington, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
So
yeah.
So let's take Peter's other question, which was around fish and consumption pathways, which we know comes up a lot in this community about, like, what about that piece? And I know, Amy, you mentioned it a little bit. Can you just go to that again? And then Mindy will go to you.
Sure. Yep. So when we did our initial evaluation of the certain biota pathways that were relevant, we identified freshwater is usually the first thing you look into with PFAS, because we know PFAS bioaccumulates in fish, in freshwater systems particularly. But we identified that they're no longer stocking in the freshwater areas around the peninsula. It may have been stocked at the time that you were there. It probably was. But since then, it has no stocking of fish occurs, and it's generally not freshwater fishing wasn't identified essentially as something that's an activity that's ongoing in the area. So we haven't sampled fish in that area under the assumption that recreational fishing is not really occurring at this time in that area. So should that turn out not to be true, should we find more information, it could lead to sampling, but at this point it hasn't been identified.
Let's go to Mindy.
Thank you. So along those same lines, I still remain concerned about shellfish as well. And there are no planned sampling efforts in this phase for shellfish. You have done some before, but many of the RAB members pointed out some of our concerns around shellfish that wasn't, we don't think, addressed, in addition to the fish that Peter was just talking about. So I just wanted to know, since there's no planned sampling of shellfish or fish, what is the threshold or criteria by which we're gonna use to evaluate that information in the future? If there's nothing, what's the trigger to make that happen?
So we have an approach document in draft that we have sent to the regulators. So once we have that, some concurrence on that, we'll be able to brief what the plan is. But at this point, it's all very much in draft. So I can't really speak further to it at this time.
So what does that mean? Can you explain to me what that document is that you're talking about?
It's just a draft approach document so that we're going to figure out essentially what our criteria is and to document it. But it's in draft at this point. So there's not, you know, there's just not much I can say about it until we've actually, you know, had a chance to talk to the regulators about what that approach will look like. And once we have done that, you know, we will definitely be discussing it. But at this point, that is not part of this current investigation. It's not what we're prepared to talk about today.
Other questions? There's a lot of information put out, sort of invitation to look at the map layers that are related to the work plan. Michael, go ahead. Wait, you are muted.
Sorry, you'd think I'd know it by now. I'd like to know what you mentioned the regulators. I'd like to know whether the regulators have approved the plan that was released and what comments you got from them and what changes, if any, you made based on comments from both New Hampshire DES and from US EPA.
You mean for the plan for this next period of the next RI work?
Right, the plan that's been released, yeah, that we've had access to, that Amy's been describing here today,
yep,
along with Hank.
So either Wood team, they have approved it. And then,
yep,
I think that's also an invitation to Mike or Peter from EPA or DES, if there's anything you want to say at this point about
Sure. We similar to the sessions that we had with you folks in the pre-scoping realm, once we had the draft work plan in place, we sat down with the Air Force, or virtually with the Air Force and the Wood team, and went thoroughly through the entire document and used that as a sounding board to adjust samples, sampling locations, certainly looking back at the information that we gathered through those info sessions. And then once those changes were finalized, we also provided a written comment. My comments will be posted on our One Stop. It was a couple of pages of very specific, points to follow up on.
Have they been posted, or are you saying they're going to be posted?
They need to get posted. The work plan is on both the Air Force Administrative Record website as well as New Hampshire DES's One Stop page. I got to get my comments posted up there.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'd just like to add that, if you don't mind, this has been, I think there's some folks in the virtual room that have gone through your classic review and comment, and, it's ebbs and flows. You get a little burst of work, and then it's all quiet, and then, months go by, and then we're back to the revised draft. So this has been very iterative. It's been very collaborative. We did work a lot of this on the fly. And, again, I think what's unique about the site is that it hasn't sort of gone in that sort of pattern or sort of flow. It's been very consistent. It's been constant, and it's been at a high level. So, this is a rapidly evolving conceptual site model, and we continue to try to work in that vein. So a lot of the review, and Peter, as Peter suggested, it was a top to bottom review, but we were able to sort of do it in a very sort of collaborative, working to try to sort of make sure we got everything. At least if there was something that we couldn't use that was existing, then we requested further work to be, new wells to be drilled, new samples to be placed, and whatnot. So, I guess I just want to sort of, again, from a team standpoint, I'm trying to be complimentary to the Air Force and their effort to try to put together a very comprehensive work plan, realizing that this is going to be iterative. And again, the data always drives your next round, how extensive or how not extensive it is. So, we'll see what the data shows. And that's how you have to proceed with this. And, remember, folks, this is a 4,300 acre peninsula. This is not a 20 acre landfill site in New Hampshire. So there is a lot of work there, and there's a lot of work that remains to be done. So I just want to sort of give some people some context of what this work plan means.
Hey, are there written comments from US EPA?
Yes, there is. And then, like I said, we've tried it from a working level, tried to sort of document sort of those modifications as we sort of, again, using past documents, past information, past data, past points of view. So, yeah, I mean, I can certainly make that available, but there's no surprises. I mean, there's, I think about 500 samples that are part of this first phase in various media. So again, each one is not, we don't go down to that minutiae level of every point, whether this needs to be moved 20 feet this way or that way. We try to figure out what our data quality objectives are and how to best meet those. So, and that's where the data is going to tell us more. It's not going to tell us everything. And then we have to take that data and put it together with the other data and to try to figure out the best way forward to meet those BQOs.
Mike, I just suggest to you that the purpose of your outreach today, the purpose of the outreach that the Air Force engaged in with members of the RAB to work on the design of this, is all aimed towards building public confidence in the scope of this. And you should do whatever you can to get it out to the public, what you've been doing to help make this a better RI study.
Yeah, that's fine, Mike. And what I'm trying to say is we work together, so I can show you many letters of correspondence. put together.
I'm talking about the public generally. It's not about me.
Yeah, no, I understand that. I guess what I'm trying to say, sir, is that, you know, again, I can certainly show you numerous letters of 20, 30 pages, but again, it was much more fluid and much more collaborative. And we got to that endpoint where we are today but that's fine. I can certainly, we can share you those notes and how we sort of came to the design. And what I'm also trying to tell you is that we weren't at loggerheads with any of this, given, again, sort of the advanced conceptual site model we had. And we're able to sort of put together a pretty comprehensive plan that's going to hopefully meet a lot of our objectives. So, but that's fine. I hear what you're saying. Okay.
Thank you both.
Yeah, one of the things,
I would like to go to Peter because he's had his hand up for a few minutes.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Peter Clark from Senator Shaheen's office. I just had a quick question. Our office has been told that a review of the applicable or relevant and appropriate requirements or ARARs, such as the state's MCLs, would be reviewed during the remedial investigation. And just trying to get more information there, would that happen before the results in September of 2022, or is that something that would happen after the results around September of 2022?
Thank you. There definitely was some conversation about that at the last RAB meeting, and then a little follow-up. Val, do you want to go?
Well, yeah, I'm just trying to, it's not part of the ARAR discussion is further down the road. I mean, I was looking at the CERCLA timeline to see when exactly it is. But it's further down the road. I guess we'll just take that is a good question. A lot of people, I will say in general that a lot of people have had questions about the things that happen past this work plan, and so I will be trying to root those out in the next RAB meeting to try to identify those questions. Apparently they've been asked before and never answered, or they were partially answered. And his question is along those lines. So we have a lot of correspondence on that within the Air Force to various parties about when we'll be looking at those things. And when they'll be considered. So I think we can give a better answer offline. So we'll do that.
If I can just say something quickly too. I mean, in the RI report, we do normally pull out and identify ARARs because that is part of the process then for, you know, identifying treatment options. You need to know what thresholds you're gonna use. We will certainly reach out at some point during the ARARs, during the RI process to identify ARARs.
Yeah, can I just add something though from a practical standpoint? And again, it gets back to the work plan. And, you know, again, I think the question that you're wondering, or I think Peter was getting to, is again, the state ARARs. So again, if you look at the work plan, you know, again, they've identified those AGQS as project action levels. So we're using those essentially to make some of our decisions. So, I mean, that sort of answers your question right there. And at least with regard to this, and, you know, at least for, you know, additional sort of work in that regard, in terms of considering state ARARs in future work. So, but I just wanted to point that out. I think from a practical standpoint and the work plan standpoint, they're there, so.
Thank you. Andrea, go ahead.
Thanks. I have a couple questions. The presentation said you're going to test 25 PFAS. Are you going to test the samples for anything else? Are there any other contaminants you're looking for in any of these samples?
I think Hank can speak to that one, but I think we're doing perchlorate in one area. Am I right about that?
Yes, we're doing perchlorate at the munitions residue burial site.
Okay.
And is that the only other? Everything else is just PFAS, right?
I think so. I believe so.
This is Mike again. I think it's a good question. And again, it's sort of highlighted in the work plan. But again, when there's sort of an overlay of other sort of legacy contamination, you sort of have to consider that as part of risk evaluation. So, and again, there's a lot of there's ongoing monitoring as part of the other legacy cleanup and investigation work, or investigation cleanup work. So, you know, again, where those sort of combined or overlay, you know, we'll have to figure out or consider that as part of our, you know, the overall risk evaluation. So.
Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to better understand more about the biota. So it sounds like that's not going to happen in this first phase, but I guess I think the community has been really clear about our concerns, like as Mindy said, the shellfish, but many other biota that could be impacted by PFAS. So, but I think what I want to be clear about, because we're not hearing a commitment from the Air Force tonight that they are going to do that testing. We're hearing a commitment to do this first round, and then that data is going to inform the next round. Is it possible that the Air Force would not test any biota based on the results that come back? Or is it, yes, we will test biota, but we just need to determine which ones? I would like some more clarification on that, because I think we've been really clear in our advocacy for that.
So the gardens, I've not heard any discussion that we won't be doing it. So as far as I know, we will be sampling gardens this. The idea is to get into this summer and be able to sample gardens. It's a matter of getting all of the pieces in order for that. So as I said, there's a human health risk assessment methodology document. That document has screening levels in it for various types of biota. So we need approval of that before we can, you know, we can actually collect the samples so that we have a way to put them into context and we know what any concentrations that come back mean. So that's one piece of it. There are other pieces of it that have to do with, like you said, the data collection. So we need to know, is PFAS actually detected in the groundwater that's being used to irrigate? If it's not, or if those gardens are being irrigated with treated municipal water that has no PFAS in it, there's not very useful collecting that biota sample. So it's figuring out those approaches and in what situation do we collect it, and you know, in what situation does it not make sense to collect it versus it does make sense to collect it. So that's all the sort of stuff that we're figuring out. It's not being ignored. I know it's frustrating that we can't give you really specifics on it at this point, but I can't roll out something to you that is so draft that, you know, basically the pieces are still moving around. But we will, you know, we will definitely be talking more about this in the coming months. And I would expect that now that this field operation has started, that's going to be kind of one of the main next pieces that we are working on. So I would assume that, you know, as I said, in the coming months, you're going to hear a lot more about it.
Mm-hmm. What does the coming months mean, Amy? Like at the June RAB, we could hear something, or are we talking not probably until the fall?
Well, it will be, there will be some information. I mean, we're planning to sample this summer if possible. But like I said, there's a bunch of moving pieces to, you know, so I need regulator commitment on when they can approve work plans. And, you know, we're going to have some discussions about that approach document. I can't commit to a specific date, only that we're pushing it as fast as we can. And we would like to sample this summer.
Okay. I would just like to ask that we're kept up to date.
Time critical.
Yeah, I mean, this again, the contract was awarded last summer, and we're, you know, I think 9 months, and we're already collecting samples. And that, again, that gets back to the review, the quick review, and trying to sort of make some really good headway this spring. So, you know, that's why we've been in this mode, is to try to sort of move this along, to help get the data to support that next, whatever it is that needs to be done or should be done, so.
Mm-hmm.
And this is unique. This is unique for the amount of time and the level of effort. This is high speed. This is high, fast pace work. So,
are you good, Andrea?
Yeah, I guess I would just say that as a community member, it's frustrating to be on the outside. There's all these draft plans. It's directly affecting our community. We've given a lot of input, and we still feel a little bit in the dark about what's going to happen. You know, and so that's that. I hear what you're saying. I am grateful for the work that you're all doing, but just try to understand our perspective that it's frustrating not to know. And it's frustrating not to be able to see drafts and to have more input into the process. So I'll just, I guess, end with that. And then, you know, the last thing I just want to state, I know Val, you're the interim project manager, but, you know, one thing that's come up a lot at our RAB and a concern to our community is that we do have private wells in Newington that are above the New Hampshire MCLs for PFAS, but below the EPA's health advisories, and the Air Force is not taking action at those homes. And frankly, in our community, we think that's unacceptable. We don't think the Air Force should be able to pick and choose what regulations they follow. The state of New Hampshire went through a process based in science to set those MCLs. And, you know, I know as a RAB community co-chair, I just want to continue to iterate that we feel the Air Force should be taking full responsibility, and they're not taking responsibility in that situation. And it is something our community will continue to advocate for. Thank you.
Thanks, Andrew. Let's go to...
That's noted, and we're aware of that.
Thank you. Let's go to Peter and then Chris.
And it's the issue...
Peter, go ahead.
I was talking. Can you hear me?
Oh, now I can, yeah. Go ahead. Sorry, Val. Go ahead.
Well, I was trying to say a couple things. One, I mean, I acknowledge what Andrew's saying, and we have state standards across the whole program, Air Force, DOD, with the Office of Secretary of Defense, and how we're addressing state MCLs and so forth and so on in both public and private drinking water wells. So that's a big topic in Washington and at the service level. So absolutely, we hear you. And if there's ever a policy change, we'll act on it. The other thing I wanted to mention was just back on the RI work plan. One of the things that came to light in my time frame after Roger left was the sampling of old wells. There were wells that have been in existence for several years that were sampled for PFAS back in 2015 or 2016. And someone brought up the issue of sampling those wells and getting a fresh look at them and see what levels they're at. And so we added those. We added some other samples as well. In my 30 days to roll out the plan, we added. So I guess the thing I wanted to not take credit for, but just emphasize is we've been adding sample locations and adding wells and sampling those old wells was actually a very good idea. And so not my idea, but someone's a good idea. And so we've been adding and adding and adding. We will get this rolling. And then, like I said, I think it's in the slides, you know, there is the additional sampling that will need to take place based on the data that comes back and then based on what's observed. So there's observations and then there's actual technical data that will be reviewed. It's going to be a fast iterative process, no doubt about it. And then on the final thing on the RAB, we will see what we can say in 3 weeks about giving you a little bit more insight into it. So we'll see what we can say about the work plan preparation and so forth and so on. So go ahead.
Thank you. Done. Peter, Drinkwater, did you want to get in? Or did you take your hand down? You're muted.
Am I muted now?
No, you sound good.
Oh, okay. Thank you. I think the only question I had was this, and I think it was answered. There is no safe level, apparently, of this contaminant or these contaminants that you can have within your system. There's no level that's known that's safe. There is a threshold that's been set for what's considered safe by EPA within water or within soil. But within the human body, is there a threshold of what's been set? And is that what's being measured against? Or how is the human factors part of this working? I don't think I understand.
There isn't a safe level in blood. So, for example, with lead, you can take a blood test the lead, and you can actually compare that to a safe threshold. With PFAS, we don't have that information yet.
With lead, there is a way to get it out of your system too.
Correct. Yeah.
But with PFAS, I'm understanding there's no way to chelate it or get it out. You can't just take something and bind it up and get it out of your system.
Right. It does eventually pass through. It does have an elimination, but it's quite long. It's a long half-life in your system. So it stays in your system for quite a good, a period of time. But yeah, at this point, as you said, we're using the EPA's safe thresholds, but they don't, they don't actually correlate to a blood level of PFAS. So
eventually though, just on the biology side of it, eventually it does pass out of your system.
It does.
Through some process.
Right.
And I assume that's through just normal elimination or things like that.
Right.
Okay, well, that's interesting. So in other words, if you went back and looked at people who were exposed at high levels 40 years ago and died, would there still be high levels in those, that gets dissipated out into the soil from those bodies, or how does that work? I'm just curious, or we don't know.
That I don't know, but I can tell you that.
Well, I was thinking animals. I'm saying humans, but let's say animals. I mean, animals would eat something. The stuff might be contaminated. The animal develops something, dies. Then it's in the soil or eaten by another animal. Does it continue to pass through the chain, or does it?
It can bioaccumulate. So yes, if one animal eats another animal, that PFAS will go into that other animal. So it can bioaccumulate. I can tell you. So essentially, PFOS and PFOA were phased out. So they're not created in the US anymore, and levels in the blood have dropped after the period at which they were phased out. If you look at these nationwide studies, they have looked into it over a period of years, over 10 years, the levels do decrease over time. So it suggests that once you stop the pathway, once you stop taking in these chemicals, they do eventually move through your system and are eliminated. So, that's a positive thing, I think. And that's part of, what this process is all about, is trying to stop those major exposure pathways. First it was the drinking water
I'm going to go to Chris, and then Mindy also had her hand up. But there are, I think, just to note, this forum isn't like filled with experts on the human health side. There are some other forums and places that are better for the human side. This forum's really is really focused on the remediation of the groundwater in particular, which is very close. They're like,
I'm with you. And the whole reason the money's being spent to do all of this is because of the risk to humans, not so much a risk of water. It's the pathway to which humans are getting it. But my one last question. So the PFOAs and PFOSs that were used in the AFFF of the 1960s and 70s and 80s are no longer made. Is that what I'm understanding? The firefighting foams today are not using the same chemistry as they were in the 70s. That's
correct.
Gone.
Right.
Okay. Now, the other part of it is that the PFOAs and PFOSs, I assume, from the chemistry of the 1970s, which is my time when I was in using that stuff, that was the stuff that was the most contaminant. Is that correct? That period of time, 1960s, 70s, we were using the older formula. They didn't phase out that to the new AAA. The stuff that's going on today over in crash rescue firefighting on airports, military bases, is not using the same chemistry as they were using in the 70s. That's all been phased out. Is that what I'm understanding? That no longer is a risk to those people because it isn't used anymore.
Right. The AFFF specifically that we're talking about right now is not currently in use. There are different formulas.
Right. And so the bottom line is for dinosaurs like myself, it would seem pretty simple for us to get measured, and then eventually we're going to get phased out. So it will no longer be an issue anyway. Okay. I got it. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go. We're going to go to Chris, and then Mindy, and then Frank. Chris, go ahead.
Thank you, Anna. First, thanks to the Air Force and the Woods team for your presentation today and for your ongoing study. I have one question that I apologize if it's, but it was not clear to me. If a well or surface water draining from a site, in my case, Site 8, is collected and used for landscape watering of trees, bushes, grass, is exterior contact with any suspected risk to animals or human alongside these pools or plants?
So with PFAS, it doesn't absorb very well from water through skin. So when we're evaluating risks to humans from a water source, it's typically from ingestion. So how we would evaluate that if someone is irrigating with the water, for example, we might assume they intake a mouthful of water, and that would be the exposure pathway. But if it's just contact, then we would assume that would be negligible.
Thank you, Amy.
Great, thanks. Mindy, go ahead.
So I just wanted to follow up on Peter Clark's question on behalf of Senator Shaheen about the ARARs. And it kind of sums up a lot of the concerns that we have in terms of, you know, whether or not we're really evaluating all the pathways to exposure sufficiently and what those end goals will be. And as Andrea had stated, we're concerned about the fact that the Air Force has been to this date unwilling to abide by the state MCLs. And so I would like to know that that not only are we going to be updated on this memo that Amy was talking about, hopefully in our next meeting in June, but also the status of the ARRs to the RAB as well, not just to Senator Shaheen, but I'd like to hear about that in our next meeting, the progress on that, because I think that is essential in determining not only what the cleanup criteria will be, but also what the exposure pathways and what the exposure limits should be in each of those pathways. So I would like to hear an update in our next meeting and continuing on the ARR development.
Thank you. Noted. Frank, go ahead.
Yes. Hi. Thank you. This is Frank Getchell. I'm a hydrogeologist who works for the city of Fort Smith, dealing with PFAS impacts on their supply wells. I just had a question regarding the presentation. Hank had shown some excerpts from the RI. And I noticed the one page that was up there referenced bedrock lineaments and geophysical logging. Was that information used or incorporated into the understanding of the hydrogeology and where you're going to be siting the new proposed monitor wells? Or is it just an overlay, you know, in terms of just your overall current understanding of what's going on conceptually with the hydrogeology?
Hank, I think that's a question to you or Amy. Yeah.
Yep. No, I can handle that one. Hi, Frank. The deep bedrock program is the next phase of work that we're going to be doing. So to kind of formulate our overall conceptual model, you know, we incorporated the borehole geophysics and the photolineaments. And I think there's a map in the work plan in section one, I believe. In fact, I can probably even pull it up, but if you want to see it. The sighting of the overburden and fractured bedrock well clusters that we have was really mostly based on where there were existing data gaps from the ESI, from the basewide SI, and from the Site 8 SI. And once we get that data in and evaluated, we're going to be examining, you know, placement of deeper bedrock wells, and we're going to look much harder at that liniment distribution as well as the borehole geophysical logging results.
Okay, so it's not really going to be part of the current work plan focus, but it's something in the future. And I guess just one other thing on that, is there information, Hank, in the RI work plan regarding the downhole geophysics that was associated with the preparation of that map? Or is that in some prior study or reports?
That it is in other reports, and it's referenced, I believe, in the figure was drawn with the borehole geophysical results, and I'll just pull it up real quick so people can see what we're talking about.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sorry. I need to share my screen though real quick. Share screen. And can everybody see that?
Yep, thank you.
All right, so and we'll go down to the south. I'm going to move down to the south where the city wells are. And so what we're talking about are these little white boxes here with these are called Rose diagrams. And this shows you, this red direction shows you the dip of fractures, water bearing fractures. So this is north is to the top. So this is kind of northwesterly dip. And these two, this just the blue is a strike, but the red here is the same. It's kind of northwesterly, and then these other lines here are photolineaments, and these are interpreted features from high altitude photographs that may or may not be fractures, but there's something that is visible from a high altitude photograph that is linear, and so it's drawn and you can. There's various interpretations for it, but anyway, that's what this map is showing. There's a lot of, you can see there's a lot of a lot of these liniments are in the direction of dip and in the direction of strike, which is 90 degrees to dip. But anyway, the placement of our wells was not necessarily based on this, but this is part of our conceptual site model. We've incorporated this information into our conceptual site model, and the future work the additional work that we're going to be doing to look at the bedrock component will be looking at this. We've also logged four wells, 4 additional bedrock wells as part of this phase of RI work. And we're going to create diagrams similar to this that we're going to be using. And those are up to the north, in the weapon storage area, and in this area here, and also over at site 13 in this area here. So that's that in a nutshell is how we're going to use that data. And in the work plan, the reference to these logs that were used to generate these Rose diagrams is provided in the work plan.
Thank you, Hank.
Andrea, go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I just wanted to go back to the ARAR discussion. Secretary John Henderson had sent a letter back to our New Hampshire congressional delegation last fall saying the ARRs would be looked at in the RI process. So I just was wondering if we could turn to Val to get some more clarification on that, because I feel like I think you had told Peter Clark from Senator Shaheen's office that it wasn't going to be part of this process. So if you could just help us better understand when we can expect that, in what process and what phase.
Val, are you there?
I'm sorry, I was reading up on that. I just read the letters. In fact, I have them up because there's a slightly different wording in each of the letters. There's a letter I would say that because this letter is dated after the other letter, the 21st October letter says It does say, as you note, we will also consider state ARARs during this phase of the process. Additionally, if at any time the CERCLA process we find, okay, so this letter says it is part of the RI phase. It is part of remedy selection. So I guess remedy selection can be at the very back end of the RI. But what we'll do is we will try to put, rather than saying it like, you know, vaguely, like it's part of the RI, it's part of the whatever, it's part of some box on a timeline. Andrea had mentioned in the last in a planning meeting, I think for one of these meetings, you talked about the schedule, you know, wanting to see some transparency on our schedule, our overall schedule, as best we can plan it at this time, given the contractual actions that have to happen and so forth and so on. But you were alluding to that, and we've thought a little bit about it, and we can think a little bit about it more before the next RAB, because I think that would be, I think it would be helpful when that issue comes up in the process. So I mean, to answer very specifically, yeah, it's the vague way of saying it is it's part of remedy selection, but you can have an interim remedial action that's part of your remedy. You could have an interim remedial action that becomes the remedy, hypothetically. So remedy selection can be, you know, at any time. So I think we need to define, for the RAB what we're talking about here when we say when specifically the AWARs will be considered.
Yeah, and there's one thing I'll add to that. This is Rob Singer from Wood. Yeah. Is that when we talk about AWARs, it's a very, very broad category of applicable and relevant and appropriate requirements that and just to give some examples, like if you were to do some sort of remedy and that remedy had an air discharge stream, like you had a generator backup for the plant that would emit emissions from a generator. Well, there's Clean Air Act requirements that are applicable to that remedy. So it's really the full spectrum of laws and regulations and everything that apply to a remedy. So usually when we start looking at ARARs, it comes into play as we start to discuss what the actual remedial alternatives are going to be. So it happens at the very end of the RI as we get into the feasibility study. And if at any point in the process we have interim actions like the Ames and the Site 8 plants, there are ARARs that will get developed for those. For example, we look at the Site 8 and the Ames interim mitigation systems. Both of those discharge water that is below the New Hampshire groundwater criteria, because those were determined to be appropriate and relevant requirements for the discharge from those plants. So it really is very, it's not just about whether the New Hampshire MTLs apply or not. It's a much broader spectrum of applicable requirements. I don't know if that helps explain it at all.
Yeah.
Thank you. Andrea, are you set for the moment?
Yeah, I feel like you made it more confusing, Rob. I thank you for trying to help explain, but I guess what it boils down to is there's private wells that are above the New Hampshire MCLs. The Air Force is the responsible party, and they're not taking action at those homes. And the community wants to know why, and they want to know when they're going to reconsider taking action at those homes. So I feel like, and it seemed like, from the letter from John Henderson, that this was going to be looked at again in the RI process. And I guess I'm even more confused now if that's truly going to happen in this process. So I'm sorry, I'm not all set. I'm more confused.
So I think what we'll need to do is we'll need to come up with a more detailed response for you outside the scope of this meeting, I would say.
Thank you. Michael Donahue, go ahead.
Rob, you mentioned site aid in the IMS that's ongoing there. Do you have an update on the status of that and whether we're at full capacity there and what the processing rate is?
Yeah, so as of end of last week, we had 9 of the 10 wells running. The 10th well produces virtually very, very little water. And I think we're up at very close to what the aquifer can produce up there. So the measures that we took last summer to put in that pretreatment system are working well.
So you're close to the 110 gallons per minute?
Yeah, the aquifer is making closer to 80 right now. It just it's what the aquifer does. So we have the plant capacity to treat, but it's what the aquifer stabilizes at.
All the more reason to keep studying this.
Yep.
Other things on people's minds? Questions? We, I think then we can move to wrapping up, and we have a RAB meeting coming up in just a few weeks. So it's a nice short time frame. So you can keep sort of thinking about these things and we can pick up the conversation. Those of you who are RAB members then, and the rest of you, you know, feed your thoughts to Wood and to the Air Force, to me. We have four, a couple of wrap-up things we wanted to go through. A reminder that there's an email address. Maybe can somebody from Wood just put that email address into the chat for where the sort of the RI email where people should send thoughts?
Yes,
so that people can copy that. Thank you. I'm going to ask if Cam, can you post that kind of survey question link in also. We have a couple of follow-up questions and a little bit of an evaluation. We would love it if you would take 2 minutes and just fill it out. Cameron is going to put that link into the chat so that we can keep improving our sessions. The next RAB meeting is June 9th from 4 to 6 p.m. It will also be a virtual meeting still for the time being. So look for an agenda and registration link for that soon. And then we'll be posting the recording of this online as soon as we can. Any other closing comments from especially Wood and the Air Force? Anything else we didn't?
I got a quick question. This is Mike. It just picks up where you left off, Ona, with regard to the virtual. I was just curious, I'm just love to sort of query the sort of interest level in getting together back in person, how people feel. I've been vaccinated and, I bet you a lot of folks have been, but I'm just sort of curious more than anything how folks are comfortable, not comfortable with trying to get together. I know this is probably not the ideal setting, but it's worked pretty good thus far. So I was just more curious than anything how folks felt.
Yeah, let me jump in. We in the Air Force, we have a couple of other RABs that are looking to going to a hybrid. They're calling it a hybrid. In other words, just the key RAB members would be meeting in person. We don't have a date for this hypothetical thing, but so like just the key players would meet in person, and then it would also be broadcast as well as a Zoom call. So you could have anyone who doesn't want to meet in person potentially on the call. So it would be online and RABs. And that could be RAB members as well. So if a RAB member doesn't want to participate. So anyway, so that's a hybrid scenario that some people are going to go to. And they're talking about going to it like very soon, like in the next few weeks. So anyway, I thought that was interesting. I'm not sure that can be done for June 9th, but maybe it could.
We'll not pivot for June 9th.
Yeah, not June 9th.
Planning side, we won't do it for June, but I think, thank you for raising it, Mike. I think the planning team needs to take it up. And I think it's a great question to ask the RAB members also, and maybe others who get our mailings about kind of comfort and maybe putting out some different options to just
And again, I know we're still making
together.
Yeah, we're still making progress, I guess, I think, as a country, and you know, certainly New Hampshire's well along, and you know, their vaccine people, number percentage vaccinated, so that's all good stuff. But you know, it was just curiosity. I mean, this has come up. I think we're all sort of collectively thinking about it. I have other forums, and so it's an interesting question. And you know, again, I certainly would definitely defer to folks, you know, how they feel. I mean, if people not comfortable, I would not. That's fine. I think we can work through those issues. So
we will be doing it, all of us collectively, for everything soon. So thanks for flagging it, Mike. We'll pick it up. Thank you, everyone. I hope you see the forum link that Cameron put in and take a moment to give us a little feedback, and really appreciate all of your time on this beautiful spring evening and your attention, and we will be back in touch soon. Be well, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks, Ona.